Hello and welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up, we'll take a closer look at all the updates to the Microsoft 365 admin experience, including everyday time savers with user templates, tailored and interactive quick setup recommendations, the brand new global reader role, updates to the Compliance Center as well, new information barriers and those policies to actually stop internal collaboration where there might be a conflict of interest. And to do that, I'm joined once again by Navjot Virk, a leader on the team that builds the Microsoft 365 admin experiences. Welcome back.
Thank you for having me.
All right, so you've done a ton of work for IT admins, and I think there's probably a few IT admins here with us today. So what's the team been working on, and how do you make things better?
So we've been doing a lot of work, and you'll see a few themes emerging in the work we've been delivering. First, we want to save you time with common tasks. And beyond that, we want to make it really easy for you to protect all of your information and keep up with your regulatory needs.
All right, well, so I'm going to start by showing us a few things that we can do now, kind of at the top level of the Microsoft 365 Admin Center.
Sure. So given the amount of time all of you spend in the Microsoft 365 Admin Center, we want this experience to be really intuitive. So the first thing you'll notice on the landing page is that it is a streamlined view of the things you use most often based on our telemetry. It's clean, there's no clutter. You can easily find what you're looking for. You can use search if you're looking for something deeper. You can customize this page to meet your needs. So it's very easy for you to add a card for something you're interested in if that's not already on the page. You can easily move these cards around to make the page look exactly the way you want. You can even customize the left navigation bar. So I happen to be the compliance admin for my organization.
Right.
So I'm going to quickly add the compliance center.
Love this. This is great. Yep.
Yeah. And just with one click, so I can easily get back to this compliance center and get my job done quicker.
Awesome.
Now, the next thing I want to show you is not going to save you time, but it might save you your eyes. So we introduced the dark mode in many of the user applications earlier this year, and I'm happy to announce that we're bringing it.
Yes, I think you can clap.
Yes, yes.
I'm a big fan of dark mode. I use this on all my phone apps. I use it in all the portals I can with debuggers. All these things should be dark mode, in my opinion.
Yes, so you can use it now in M365 admin as well. But actually, I happen to like light mode, so I'm going to switch back to light mode. Now, I know that there's another thing where a lot of you spend a lot of your time, and that is user management. So over the last year, we've done a lot of work to bring all user controls across Microsoft 365 into this single pane here, so you can see all the user settings, and you can manage them without having to dig deep into various admin experiences.
Right.
And beyond that, we're also making it really easy for you to add a lot of users, especially if you don't want to use PowerShell or CSV files.
Nothing wrong with PowerShell or CSVs. I love them.
No, we love them. Nothing wrong with them. But exactly. In case you want to use UX, you can now use user templates to add users with similar attributes.
Okay.
So in my case, I need to add a bunch of new employees, temporary employees in the New York office. So I'm going to create a template for that. And to do that, all I need to do is give this template a name, hit next. I'm happy to have all of these users have an auto-generated password. I'm going to assign all of them the same E3 license. And then there is some profile information that is common for all of these employees. So all of them are going to have the same job profile. They have the same department. And they're all going to be part of the same office in New York. I hit next. I'm done editing. And I saved this template. Now, I can quickly add these users using this template. So let me try and add a user.
Okay.
So I'm going to go back to the templates. I'm going to use this newly saved New York temp staff template.
Okay.
And all I have to do is give the first name, the last name. I want the same display name. And then I'll give the username, which is the email address. And then I'm done. Add the user. And that's it. With three clicks, I've added a user. And of
amazing.
Course,
and yeah. This is amazing, especially for things like seasonal staff, where you're hiring maybe 50, 100 people with the same attributes. So the user management task, I think, is something that everybody uses, including myself, every single day. But what else have we been focusing on to save people time?
So another thing, we know that many times you don't know what you don't know. And we want to make it really easy for you to onboard to Microsoft 365 and get maximum value out of your subscription. So to help you with that, we're now introducing guided setups. Mm-hmm. On this page, You can discover different services and controls that are available to you as part of your subscription. But not just that, it actually gives me recommendations for things I should consider enabling to get the most value.
Okay.
So in this case, you'll notice that, for example, it's recommending that I increase protection from advanced threats. So if I want to learn more, I can click View. It takes me to this page that tells me more about this control, tells me all the user impact that will happen if I enable this control,
right,
and also tell me where I can go to learn more about it.
Okay.
Now, if I want to turn this on, I can do it right from here. I say Get Started. It picks up some great defaults. If I'm happy with these defaults, I say Create Policies, and that's it. With two clicks, I have enabled advanced threat protection without having to go deep into the security center.
Awesome. And it did that, all that stuff kind of pre-default, gave you some recommendations there. You got it all out of the box. But you can always go back later, and it gives you the deep link to be able to go back later and kind of tweak those settings and configure them to your needs.
Yes, absolutely. We've also been on a journey to make the various admin experiences across Microsoft 365 more cohesive so that they look and feel the same, but they also act the same. So I'm going to show you the new Security Admin Center landing page. You'll notice it looks a lot like the landing page of the M365 Admin Center. I have a similar concept where I can add cards to customize this page. I can move these cards around. I can even customize my left navigation bar, just like in the M365 Admin Center. The idea is to save you time by giving you experiences that are consistent and predictable.
All right, but I want to drill into an issue I think a lot of people probably have. Tell me if this isn't true. You might have too many global admins. People want to be able to see the reports, the usage, those kind of things. Are we doing anything to where we can stop having everyone get global admin access to our tenants?
Yes. We all know this is a major ask from a lot of you. We know it's not a great conversation when, for example, your manager asks you for a global admin right just so they can look at some report on a portal or some configuration. And you know that they're just one click away from accidentally either taking down the service or locking it down too much.
Anyone ever have something like this happen to you? Few people, yeah. Don't be ashamed. I've had this happen. It happens to us.
Yes. And, you know, it's not safe and secure to have so many global admins.
Right.
So to help you with that, we're introducing the new global reader role.
Okay.
The idea is that users with this role can view things in the admin experiences, but they cannot make any changes. So, in fact, Jeremy.
All right, you can clap for that. The only thing I'm not clapping about, though, is it looks like you don't trust me to be a global admin in your tenant.
Oh, I absolutely trust you, but I don't want you to have more power than you can handle.
Okay.
So that's why.
Yes, that's a bad thing. I can get myself in trouble.
So I've assigned you the global reader role. So why don't you show us your experience?
Okay, so I've got my user pane kind of open up here. Everybody's pretty familiar with this. And I know that you're logged in as Megan, so I'm going to actually do my best to take away your global admin power. So I'll click into Megan. Now I can see all the information come up. So I see like all the things in terms of alias and kind of the common things, licensing state, all of that stuff. But when I go to manage your role, you see that in this case, I can't change or edit this page. I don't have any save dialogue or anything there. You see that I don't have permission through this nice dialogue that I've got to tell me. I don't have the permissions to edit that. So I can't get in trouble because the worst thing I could probably do is reset your password or take away all your admin rights, just mistakenly, like you said, because I've got too much power and I don't know what to do with it.
Exactly. So the idea here is that you can see stuff, but you cannot change anything. That's the extent of your power. But it's still pretty useful because you are getting great visibility into how your tenant is set up and being used. You just can't do any harm.
All right, so these updates look like they're going to save a lot of time to get services up and running as well and save our bosses from themselves and maybe save our own jobs in some cases in terms of if something gets shut off. But we also have a long history in terms of security and compliance control. So what's new there?
So security and compliance continues to be a huge area of focus for us because we know it's critically important to you and your business. So earlier this year, we introduced the Compliance Center, and now we're introducing a compliance score. The idea is that the score gives you a very easy way to both assess and manage your risk in this space. So as you can see for my tenant, our compliance score is 78%. Actually, most of it is coming from Microsoft Managed Controls. This page also gives me key improvement actions that I can take to improve the score. And as I scroll down, it actually gives me breakdown of different categories that contribute to the score.
Okay.
So I just noticed that Protect Information, which is a very important category, I have a 51% score. Now, I would really like to do better here, so I'm going to click on View Improvement Actions and it gives me specific actions I can take to improve this specific category. Now, one of the simplest and highly recommended way of improving protection for information in your organization is to use data classification. On the data classification page, you can see that I have two different types of labels I can apply to my organization's data. I have retention labels that I can use to apply consistent retention policies, and I have sensitivity labels that I can use to apply consistent security policies to data, depending upon the classification of the data.
Nice.
This page gives me a great overview of how I'm using these labels in my organization, what kind of data is being protected. I can also go to the sensitivity labels tab in the Compliance Center and see the various sensitivity labels in my organization. For example, the confidential label, you'll notice that for this label, I have enabled certain security policies. I want anything that is labeled confidential in my organization to have encryption. It'll be RMS protected.
Right.
I want it to have a watermark, a header footer, and some settings that are specific to groups and sites as well. Once I create these labels and publish them, end users can apply these labels to files, emails, teams, groups, and sites across Microsoft 365 to consistently protect the data.
And this is great, but I know even with like the information protection kind of bars up there in terms of being able to manually label their sensitive files, not everybody does this manually. So is there anything you can do to protect that as well?
Yes. So now not only can your users apply these labels manually, but you as an admin can create an auto-classification policy that will automatically detect files that are sensitive and apply these labels on your behalf.
Okay.
So let me show you how this works. So here I'm going to create an auto-labeling policy. I give the policy a name. And I'm going to associate this policy with some rules. So I want to make sure that any data in my organization that is of financial information, so it has more than 10 credit cards or bank account numbers or routing numbers, I want it to automatically get labeled confidential. Once I create this policy, it'll give me a little summary. So basically, apply confidential label if it meets these rules. Now, anytime you as a user are creating documents that have this information, or even existing documents that have this information, they will automatically get labeled on your behalf.
So why don't I show you what that looks like then?
Yes.
So on my computer, I'm actually working on a doc. It's just starting, so I've got some great stuff in the clipboard, so I'm going to hit Control V here, put everything in that I'm working on, and I've got some really legit credit card numbers here that I'm typing in. So all of this stuff here, it's kind of scanning the document now. If I hit Enter, it's going to look for that. And it's going to actually meet your threshold. And you'll see here that I've got this business bar that comes up. Yeah. And here we've got these organizational recommendations. I've got a policy tip. I can learn more. I can even change it if I want to. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. So I will go ahead and change this. That's going to apply the label here. It's going to apply all the protections, like you mentioned, the RMS, the encryption. And now I've protected the document. But you know, not everybody is quite as kind of tech savvy and willing to kind of press these buttons, even with a nice yellow bar. So can we protect them as well?
Absolutely. So there are many users who will ignore the bar. And if that happens, don't worry. Your data is still protected. The service will automatically scan for files that meet this criteria and apply the label on your behalf. So your data is always protected. So why don't you go look at some SharePoint document libraries and see what's happening there?
OK, so I've got my SharePoint document library open here. You can see I've got quite a few different labels in place already. So if I go ahead and click on this one, one of the interesting things that you'll see here is that we've actually got some financial services, different things that we detected. And it's through Contoso auto classification. So it's automatically been labeled as confidential by the system. So pretty cool stuff. Even if I neglect to label it, even with that yellow bar saying, please add the label, it's going to protect me on my behalf just using the system itself and the auto classification.
That's the idea. If your users are not being proactive, the service still has you covered. So your data is always automatically protected.
All right. So there are other controls then that we can use to protect information?
Yes. Another thing that many of you have been asking for, especially those of you who work in regulated industries like financial services, is the ability to create barriers between different types of users in your organization. So imagine that I'm a bank, and I have some users who work in the investment banking side, and then I have some users who work on the customer advisory side. Now, financial regulations require that these two sets of users not be able to collaborate or communicate with each other in order to avoid insider trading. So to help you with that, we're introducing information barriers. So I'm going to create an information barrier policy, but first I'm going to create some user segments. So here I have a segment called investment banking. I've assigned some users to this segment. And in fact, Jeremy, you are part of this segment.
That's actually my day job. I'm an investment banker.
I'm sure you are.
I'll be on Squawk Alley next week.
Yes. I also have a few other users here, Sesha and Jeff, who are also part of investment banking. I have another customer segment called advisory.
Okay.
And Nikita is part of the advisory segment.
Right.
And now I'm going to create a barrier between these two. So I'm going to create a policy which is going to block all communication and collaboration between these two segments of users.
Okay.
Once I save it.
You're telling me I won't be able to talk to Nikita anymore.
Why don't you try it?
All right, so I'm in my Teams console here. And I'm going to go ahead and just, like I normally would, search for Nikita. And she's in my same Azure AD, but it doesn't even resolve the username. So I don't see Nikita there. So I'm blocked. And that's kind of nice here that I don't get a "you're blocked from communicating." She's literally not there at all. So if I go ahead and try then to go into Teams and manage a team and say I want to add Nikita in that case to the team, so I'll go into Teams Management. And then I will add a member. And so I'll type Nikita's name there as well. And you'll see we don't find any matches. Again, not kind of putting it in my face that, yes, we see Nikita, but you can't talk to her. This is actually a good thing for the
folks. Yeah, but you can still collaborate with Jeff because Jeff is in your segment.
Right, exactly. So if I try to add, for example, Jeff, now that, not Jeff Teeper, but Jeff McDowell, another awesome Jeff. So I'm going to go ahead and add him. And then we have Jeff, as you'd normally expect, being added to my team. There he is. He's part of my normal members and guests. So now I'm able to, it looks like, work with you or with Jeff, but not Nikita because she's in a different segment than I'm able to communicate with. Now, this also applies to SharePoint, right?
Absolutely. In fact, information barriers are enforced across all Microsoft 365 endpoints and experiences.
All right, so let me go into SharePoint, into the document library here. So I've got one. I want to actually try to share something with Nikita in this case. So I'll go ahead and type Nikita's name. And you'll see, again, it's not resolving Nikita, even though, again, she's in the same directory. But of course, if I went to share with Jeff, I can do that. And there's Jeff. And of course, the sharing works. Because Jeff's in my segment, he's also an investment banker like me.
Correct. And that's the idea. We want to make sure that you can meet your regulatory needs and create the barriers that are appropriate for your business.
So thank you so much, Navjot. This is a great set and sampling of all the recent updates that we have for Microsoft 365 admins. But where do you recommend people go to learn more about all the things that we saw today?
So everything that I showed you today in Microsoft 365 Admin Center is available for you to use today. Please go try it. Give us feedback. And also, please go check out aka.ms/compliance previews to learn more and sign up for previews for the compliance features I just showed you.
Excellent tips. And of course, keep watching Microsoft Mechanics for the latest updates if you're an admin or even just a global reader. And we'll see you next time, and goodbye for now.